It's no secret that I love the ZX Spectrum, especially the very first model. Its rubber keys might be an abomination to some, but to me they're a thing of beauty. A moment of nostalgia frozen in a time where you need to play finger twister to get the right keywords to appear on the screen. Playing one of these 80s classics today is not without its problems though. The RF output is not well supported by modern TV tuners. And this can mean a fuzzy, drifting image, if your TV can lock onto the signal at all. But there is an answer. You can composite mod your Spectrum easily with a few wires. Or for a premium look, you can use this neat multi-option board from projectspecy.com. So we're going to build and install one, right now.
Mark fixes stuff. This video is sponsored by PCBWay. You can get an instant quote on a variety of services, or browse a library of talented makers' designs, add them to your cart, and have them delivered directly to your door.
There are three options with this board. Option 1 is an inverted emitter follower, and can be useful for composite monitors that are picky about their input. Option 2 is a simple NPN transistor mod. The board is marked for a 2N3904, but any general purpose device like a BC547 will work. Option 3 is a simple decoupling capacitor. Some people may say this isn't required, but I think it's the safer option. To build option 1, we need the following. A 2N3906 PNP transistor. A 16-volt 100 microfarad electrolytic capacitor and a standard 100 ohm carbon film resistor. For option 2, we need that general purpose NPN part. We're going to use the stated 2N3904 in a TO92 package and another 100 ohm carbon film resistor. As we can see for option 3, it's just the 100 microfarad 16 volt capacitor for decoupling. Okay, let's build the board first. This is a good project for my board holder. And this way really won't work because the clamps will be in the way, so let's rotate the PCB. That's better. Now let's clean the board down to remove any fingerprints or grot. This is 99% pure isopropyl alcohol. It cleans off anything that might stop solder sticking to the board and evaporates quickly. With the board clean, we heat the soldering iron to 330 degrees centigrade. We're going to use option 2 today. It's a very simple build. First, the 100 ohm resistor. I've got a fairly massive tip on my iron, but I'll just be using the edge of it today. I'm also using pretty cheap solder, which is a bit blobby. Next, we pop the transistor in. Note that the TO92 package has a flat side, and this needs to match the markings on the board. Slip it in as far as it can go. To stop the part dropping out when we flip the board over, we need to bend the leads out. This tip is absolutely massive, and it's hard to use it when it's this size. I've actually managed to create a solder bridge. The lesson here is use the right tool. The third leg solders well, but we need to deal with that bridge. Rubbish solder and trying to solder with a shovel has caused this. Enter the SS02 solder sucker, a premium tool from Japan. I love this for manual sucking work. and we're back in business. With our massive project built, it's time to install it in the Spectrum. Ow, you rotter! Terry and Dave have brought the rubber key for the install. We're going to install the board in the Spectrum right now. It replaces the internal RF board inside the modulator at the back of the computer. I'll not bore you with unscrewing the case. So this is the modulator can, and this one is pretty shiny. We'll need to remove it from the board first. We need to cut these two wires for the video signal and 5 volt power. This one flew off anyway. We'll need to clear the holes on the board too. For that, we could use the manual solder sucker, but I'm lucky enough to have this desoldering station. These are the two points that we need to clear. The holes clear easily. Let's remove the modulator now. The modulator is held by these two lugs soldered into the ground plane of the board. On some Spectrums, this ground plane can make desoldering a challenge, but on the Issue 3 it's easy, even with a manual solder pump. But I'm lazy, so desolder gun it is. Both holes cleared easily, and the modulator comes free with minimal force. We need to remove the top and the bottom of the modulator to replace the board. Let's take this port shroud off quickly, and gently pull off the top of the can. This is the board that we'll be replacing. And we'll wire up the new board through the existing holes. Let's take this out. I've already removed the bottom side and we can see that the board is soldered to the can. We work our way around the board, desoldering and making sure that the board is free at all points. A temperature controlled soldering iron at 330 degrees is easily enough heat for this job. With the board desoldered, it's time to remove the top brace. It's soldered on both sides of the can. With a little heat, you can easily detach it with some grips. We'll also cut the wires inside the can to make our life easier. Then, by pushing the internals down, we can remove them from the unit. If you think this might be a bit brutal, well, I have a few dozen of these Aztec units in normal condition. These ridges are to locate the board. A dry fit of the board shows where we need to put the connecting wires. We can also clear out the insulated 5V input to make space for our own 5V power wire. Let's grab some wire. The colours don't really matter. I'll strip the three wires at one end as well. I've cut them too long so that we can shorten them when they're in position. Pre-tinning the ends will make it easier to get a good solid solder connection to the PCB. We'll use the red wire for 5 volts and feed it into the proper hole. We'll use black for the video signal to the composite video PCB and solder them both in place on the board. Next, we need to put a wire from video out to the center pin of the modulator. We'll use a yellow wire to do this. With the video wire soldered into the board, we can strip, cut, and solder it precisely to the output pin. But first, it'd be a good idea to fix the board into place so it can't move after the video wire is attached. This is just a case of blobbing some solder. Easy with my massive tip, and you don't really need to do all of the points. Solid. Solid as a rock. Okay, we're ready to install this on our Spectrum board now. Placing the modulator can back into the board, we solder it firmly into place. This connection also provides the ground connection for the video signal as well. This solder really isn't great. The flux evaporates far too quickly. Lovely and solid. Cutting the 5V and video input wires to a more sensible length, we strip, tin, and solder them into the board. Red wire into the 5V point. And the black wire into the video point on the PCB. A quick touch of solder. And the board is installed. Let's just pop the lid back on the modulator can and we'll be ready to put the board back into the case. This is an insulating sheet from inside the bottom of the modulator. Remember to reinstall this. Whoops. Oh, hi guys. Let's try this out. Composite cable into the pack. This goes to the AV input on my LCD TV. And let's add a little bit of gummy power. success. Let's try a few games. We'll use my ZX Dandanator Mini that we built in a previous video. The picture is much better than RF. It looks so much better in real life than the camera can capture, but hey, that's the joy of filming screens. Now, it's time for Jetpack. I want to say a massive thanks to my amazing Patreon supporters. Here they are, and you can join them at patreon.com/markfixesstuff. Thanks for watching my video. Here are some others that you might enjoy. Bye!